He who has the pen has the power. Hello, my name is Robert Edwards. I'm the vice president of a nonprofit organization that is concerned about voter suppression. I want to talk to you very briefly about he who has the pen has the power. You must understand that as we look at this 2020 voting, it is something that has been 10 years in preparation, and that is the issue of gerrymandering. Gerrymandering is where they redraw districts every 10 years. This is important for you to understand because even though in Pennsylvania, the Democrats had over 83,000 votes, they did not win the districts 13-5. You know why? Because the districts were redrawn. Well, 2020 is time for the redrawing of the districts. And if you want to make sure that there is power, you must control the pen. You control it by voting. Voting electronically, voting in absentee ballots, voting with mail-in ballots, voting at the polls, because it is then your pen has power. And so, go out and vote, because he who has the vote has the power.
My brothers and sisters. It is Saturday for some and Sabbath for others, a time when we set aside all of our secular business to give praise to our God. our Creator. Are you feeling a little disheveled this morning, feeling a little grief concerning all of the uncertainties? It seems that every week we are inundated with something new. I want to tell you this morning that when you think about Jesus Christ, remember his name, Jesus, is only one of his names. His other name is Emmanuel, which means God with us. God is with you and me. Nothing escapes him. When you're tempted to complain, all you need to do is call the name of Jesus. He will save you, or Emmanuel, he is with you. Mm-hmm. And so on this day, if you have to turn off the television, turn it off. Take a quiet moment with the Lord and just call his name. And I promise you, through his Holy Spirit, you will find relief from your grief. And now our intercessory prayer will be rendered by Professor Pendeza Lawrence.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. I don't know about Professor yet, in Jesus' name. So it's prayer time, everyone. And I got to tell you, I don't know about you, but it's been interesting this year. I remember last year going through my husband in the hospital and my daughter in the hospital and just financial issues, work issues, to thinking, I can't wait for 2020. And then 2020 happened. Be careful what you ask for. But let's be honest, this year has been very challenging, not just for some, but for all of us. And all of us are standing in a need of prayer. This one of the things about 31st Street, aside from the fact that I miss you guys, I miss my church family. One of the things about 31st Street is we are family. And I remember being at Oakwood, and that was the consensus that we are family. So a past couple of weeks, we have lost some family members, and we are in mourning. And let's be honest, we're kind of uncertain because we don't know who else. And we just want to grab everyone and just wrap our arms around everyone. Personally, I lost a father. I lost a father. Was he someone that birthed me? No. But when I walked in that church, he stepped in. A few days later, I lost the auntie. Was it someone that we have the same ancestry or the same blood? No. But when I walked in that church, she stepped in. So I know what it feels like. Just like with everything growing up with 31st Street, we know what it feels like. We are family, and we're separated, and we're mourning, and we're in pain. But I have good news. As always, if you're a Christian, you always have some good news. And I am a Christian, so I have some good news. The Bible says, Psalms 35, the weeping may endure for a night, but not we get over it comes in the morning. Not you will be okay in the morning. Not you will be happy in the morning. But the Bible says, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Joy, unspeakable joy, joy that only God can give, comes in the morning. It hurts right now, or when it begins to hurt, get excited. For what, Pendeza? Because the Bible says, and the Bible's the word of God. So God says that joy is coming. So yes, 2020 has been hard. And for our church, rough. But let's get excited. It's hard. While we're crying, let's get excited because joy is coming and Jesus is coming. So my people are sleeping, Our family members are sleeping, just like they said for Jacob, or Israel, excuse me, Abraham and David, sleeping. But when Jesus comes, they will see him, and we will be reunited all over again. So let's pray for each other. Let's be encouraged, and let's encourage each other, because I'm looking forward to this joy. And it, you know, we don't have to wait until our Savior comes and rescue us from this earth, because he could give us joy right now because we have the Holy Spirit. Do you want it, everybody? Is everybody excited? Do you want it?
Yes.
Let's claim it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for being our God, our Savior, our Father. As 31st Street, Lord, whether we are members or we have been attending, so we are fellowshipping together and, quote, we're friends. No, we are family. So, Lord, as our family, you are our Father, and you have taken care of us in the past, right now, and you will continue to. And I want to thank you, because we don't deserve it. I can't think of anything we have done to deserve it except for just having you. You give it to us. You love us. You are our Father. You, as you have spoke the world into existence, you could speak joy and peace into our lives. And all of us that we turn our eyes upon you, our Savior, you will lift us up, Lord. So thank you for that. Thank you. And wow, I just can't, I cannot fathom how awesome you are. And yet you long to be close to us, and us too, our souls long to be a part of you. So thank you, Lord. Thank you for being our Savior. So Lord, I ask that you would forgive us of all of our sins when we have doubted you, when we have not trusted you, or when we in our actions show that we are not really sure if we could trust you. Forgive us from that, but strengthen us so that we can, because there's power in trusting and obeying your word and for leaning on the everlasting arms. So thank you, Lord. Thank you for when it hurts, you put a song in our hearts. And I can imagine that every single person, whether it's been afflicted with pain, sorrow, or hardships, there is this song that you've placed in our hearts to remind us of who you are and who is in control. And also thank you, Lord, for in the midst of our troubles, you carry us. We don't have to walk it, you carry us. And I'll be honest, Lord, it seems kind of easy. All we got to do is just put our faith and trust in you and just lean on you, spend time with you, and you take care of everything, from our jobs to our children, to our spouse, to our siblings, to our church family. You take care of us and our friends. So Lord, I'm asking that you would cover us. Some of us, Lord, are having financial hardships. And I ask for and I claim the blessings of you being our provider. Some of us have lost family members, Father, and we are claiming the peace and the joy that you, our Father, will provide. I want to thank you really quick, because I'm thinking about the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for dealing with us, putting up with our disobedience, and never leaving us, and really turning our eyes upon our Savior and giving us the strength to endure every single day. I want to thank you, Lord, for just answering our prayers before we've even asked. I ask that you will be with our country as a whole, Lord. I believe that we are divided and we are approaching election year. And I pray that no weapon formed against us will prosper. And I pray that our voice will not be muted. And I ask that you will be with our president right now, who is dealing with the coronavirus. And also please be with those who are dealing with the coronavirus and those who have lost folk to the coronavirus. And not just that, but the other diseases that afflict us upon our nation. I also ask for our church family. I ask that you continue to be with the family of Dr. Earlene Piper Mandy, Lord, and also be with the family of my dad, Mike McWilliams. And I pray for your comfort and your peace. I'm also asking, Lord, that you will continue to be with Grandison Phelps and the third, and also with Enrique and Olivia Ramirez, Lynn Ruff, Kathy Armstrong. Continue to be with Ira Echols and Kareen Johnson, Evelyn Johnson and Gloria Johnson, Father. Continue to be with Jocelyn Pride and Katie Prothrow, Sister Robinson and Brother Todd and Bunny West. I thank you for, today was supposed to be it for her, but you said no. So thank you, Jesus. Also, I ask for you to be with Noble Hobbs and Lily Moore and Elder Pinnock. Also, well, Gerald Pinnock, because there's a lot of elders in the family. Thank you for what you have done so far and continue to bless in the name of Jesus. Continue to be with Delilah, as she's going through some surgeries. That's one of our babies, Lord, as you know. And continue to be with Dottie and also with Thomas. And continue to be with Pastor Callie Williams. And I thank you for what you have done. And continue to be with Lois Laster, Lord. And in addition, Lord, continue to be with Dr. Gilbert's family over the loss of her mother. And again, as I have mentioned before, the family of our brother, our dad, our uncle, Mike McWilliams, and also Auntie Earlene's family, continue to strengthen Rocky. In this, Lord, I pray that you will be with us, because I know when they open their eyes, they will see you. But what I'm asking for is for those who remain, that you will strengthen us so that we will be reunited. The road is hard, but you are good. And I pray that we'll turn our eyes upon you, Lord, to be obedient to your word and to look forward to your coming, God, and to strengthen each and every one of us, to strengthen each other so that we can have a great reunion. You know what? To be honest, Lord, I'm not really looking forward to the great reunion when our church doors open. I will be excited. But what I'm really looking forward to is that great reunion in heaven when we can see you face to face and our loved ones face to face, and each other face to face, and we don't have to say goodbye anymore. So thank you for that, and strengthen us. In your precious and holy name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Okay, at this time, we will be blessed with our tithe and offering given by Elder Al Johnson Jr.
Amen. Happy Sabbath, church family and friends. I believe at this point, most if not all of us have already or are prepared to return our tithe and offering. There's many ways or a few ways you can actually return that, either by going to 31sda.org, which is our church website, and click the donation button and then the give tab, and then you can go on and register. Or you can send your tithe envelope by mail, addressed to 31st Street Seventh Day Adventist Church at 414 South 31st Street, San Diego, California 92114. Lastly, you can also, if you're in the area, drop by the church or 14 South 31st Street and just give it to one of the deacons there, or if you happen to see Cindy Richardson, you can give it to her as well. I'd like to encourage you this morning that when you are in your quiet space, to take a moment and read Malachi 3 verses 8 through 12. But in your hearing right now, I'm going to read verse 10. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be food in my house, and try me now, and this says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessings that there will not be room enough to receive it. Let's pray. Father God, our God, we just thank you, Father, for all you've done, Father. Thank you for the provisions you made for us, Lord, despite this pandemic, Father. For those that are struggling, Father, we financially or in any way they're struggling, Father, we thank you, Father, for the blessings you bestowed upon them, Father. We pray, Father, that you will take the offerings, the tithe that has been given in return, Father, that you will, that it will go to your need in the wherever it's going to, Father. We just pray that you will continue to bless those that are struggling in some way or form or fashion, Father. Be with this country, Father. And Lord, be with the president of our country. In the name of Jesus, I pray, amen. At this time, our special music is going to be presented to us by Sister Terry Drummond.
Good morning, church family. As Pendeza was saying, everything that we're going through right now, one day, everything will be made new. But while we're here on this earth, we have to remember that God still gives us amazing grace. We're still here to see each other on Sabbath. We're still here to love one another. Let's just remember that there is amazing grace. So I'm gonna sing Amazing Grace. Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. For it was grace that brought my liberty. I do not know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond all my faults and saw my needs. I shall forever lift mine eyes to Calvary, to view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous the grace that caught my falling soul. He looked beyond all my thoughts and saw my needs. Amen.
Amen, amen, and amen. Thank you, Terry, for that beautiful song. That is a staple in the lives of humanity, regardless of what continent you live on.
Yes.
Amazing grace.
Amen.
He looked beyond our faults and saw our needs.
Yes.
A few weeks ago, we preached the first installment of a series entitled, But God.
Mm-hmm.
But God. We learned of Paul's circular letter to the Ephesians, and we paid close attention to chapters 1 and chapter 2. Where Paul reminded us that we are endowed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. He reminds us that we are chosen, or we were chosen in Christ Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
We were adopted in Christ Jesus. We were accepted in the beloved by Christ Jesus. By the time Paul gets to chapter 2, he reminds us that we have fallen from grace and that when the human race fell from grace, we were not only dead in our sins, but we were slaves to lust of the flesh and children of wrath, just as others. Then Paul says, but God. This but God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love, made us alive to sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. For you and I, by grace, as Terry just sang, are saved through grace because of but God. And so this morning, we want to go to our second installment of the But God series. I invite you to take your Bibles and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And we want to look at verses 12 and 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 12 and 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 12 and 13. Paul says to the Corinthians, therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Amen. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit, that your spirit may take control of my spirit and speak through this body, that we would see Jesus. In the strong name of Jesus, amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Amen.
When I look at America today, I see a society and a popular culture that is decadent, depraved, and delusional. When we talk about decadence, we're talking about decaying. All of us, no matter how good we look, are in essence every moment of the day decaying back to the dust that we were made by. Our depraved manner shows our corruption. We can't help it. We are corrupt. Our delusional manner has to do with our inability to have good judgment. For we are in fact misled in a world that sees right as wrong and wrong as right. When I look at America today, I see a country that is religiously inclined towards political ideology rather than the character of Jesus Christ. They call themselves Christians, but in fact, they seem to worship at the altar of political expedience, where their lives change from day to day and minute by minute. When I look at America today, I see a nation that is not morally inclined to the dictates of Almighty God, but religiously inclined towards their gods, little G-O-D-S, in the immorality of convenience. It's all about me. It's all about my wife, my cat, and my dog, and no more. When I look at America today, I see flag wavers who are more concerned about waving their flags than they are about systematic racism or providing housing for those who live on the street, or about people of color who are forced to trudge in the waters of civil unrest by certain types of individuals who want to return to the days of Jim Crow. Christians in a Christian nation who go faithfully to church every Sunday to worship their God, but seem to disparage the fruits of true godliness in loving their neighbors as themselves, or loving God with all of their heart and with all of their soul and with all their strength and with all their mind, Luke 10:27. This was the problem with the Corinthian church. They forgot but God. That's why Paul had to do spiritual surgery on them. My New King James Bible says, and I quote, "The church at Corinth was infected with sexual immorality, split by factions that dragged each other into court, and crippled by abuse of their spiritual gifts. Yet Paul, like a surgeon, diagnosed the problem and aimed his efforts straight at the source, which was pride and a lack of true love." My brothers and sisters, I submit to you that I've had to learn a few things about myself. I do not always know where my pride is. I think somewhere in my mind, I must have thought that pride is ego. So if I'm not showing egotism, then I'm not pride. But God has shown me where some of it is. For instance, I'm a perfectionist, or I like to think of myself as a perfectionist. I want it right. I want it correct. I want it manicured. I want it executed well. But God says, "Shelton, without me, you can do nothing." Anything, my brothers and sisters, that we try to do on our own, God has shown me, is pride. Jesus, through his Holy Spirit, has taught me and says to us in the scriptures, "Cast all your anxieties on him, for he cares for us." Sometimes when I'm teaching at the university and I'm teaching a class and there's a spoiled person or a person who thinks he or she knows everything, and I'm getting a little tired of their arrogance, but God, says the Holy Spirit, knocks on the door of my mind and illuminates my memory with Paul's words, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Philippians 4:6. Paul reminds the Corinthians of a plethora of things. He reminds them with examples of the children of Israel. In verse 6, we read these words. Now these things became our examples to the intent. We should not lust after evil as they lusted. What is lust? Lust can be an intense desire, not only for sex or position, but lust for power and things, and perhaps wrong entertainment. Number two, Paul says, and do not become idolaters as some of them, for idolatry is anything that we devote ourselves to more than God. So if we are so ambitious and we're doing so many jobs and we're spending a lot of time doing, watching on television, playing, observing sports, all of that, and giving God less time, mm-hmm. we may be guilty of idolatry. Mm-hmm. Paul goes on to say, number three, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Paul says, nor let us commit sexual immorality as some of them did. And in one day, 23,000 fell. Mm-hmm. Application? During this time of COVID-19, we have people who would rather go out without a mask on, so they can eat, drink, and be merry, and play, and participate in a hedonistic society, because they are given to pleasure and play. Mm. Again, I submit to you, I have had to learn that pleasure and personality with God is idolatry. Mm. And Paul is reminding you and me during this COVID-19, when we feel bored and all we want to do is just look at the boob tube and feel good and be entertained rather than going someplace quietly mm-hmm. and talking to Jesus, who is our Savior, and Emmanuel, God with us.
Yes.
Because we have not gotten to the place where we have found but God. Mm-hmm. Paul finally, number four, says, nor let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted and were destroyed by serpents. Mm-hmm. To tempt means to seduce or entice by hope or desire to do something wrong. To allure, on the other hand, means to charm or appeal to do something unwise, that is wrong and immoral. Mm-hmm. Well, all you have to do is look at certain news channels, and there's nothing but seduction and enticement through hyperbole and straight out lying, that if you just trust them, and if you see the eyes through the lens of many of these politicians, I suggest to you, you and I have been seduced and enticed and allured. Mm-hmm. These were the people who were under the cloud Paul is talking to, these examples, who passed through the Red Sea, who were baptized by Moses under the sea, all ate the same spiritual food and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, mm-hmm. and that rock was Christ, mm-hmm. the rock of ages. Mm-hmm.
But Paul lets us know that these people, they forgot about but God, who brought them across the Red Sea on dry land. They forgot but God, who inscribed 10 commandments with his finger on stone. They forgot but God, who gave them manna 7 days a week in the desert. They forgot but God, who gave them the cloud to lead them by night, by fire, and through the desert by day. They forgot but God, who had Moses to strike the rock and cool, sweet water gushed out of the rock, but they forgot about the rock of ages. I submit again to you that sometimes you and I forget that it was but God who brought us, some of us, across the Mississippi River of Jim Crow South to this wonderful land of sunshine called California. Some of us forgot that but God who helped you and me to get our degrees from major universities. It had nothing to do with how smart we are. It has to do with that grace that Terry was singing about this morning. God gives us grace when we don't deserve it. God gives us grace not because we're good, but because he is good.
Amen.
He is but God.
Yes.
But God has to do with a God who functions between the conjunction, the coordinating conjunction. That's the God we serve. Amen. That's the grace he gives.
Yes. Amen. Yes.
We forget that it is but God who touches a certain part of our brain in the morning, and our eyes open and our feet begin to move and our toes begin to twinkle, and we realize that God's grace has awakened us, clothed in our right mind. That's because of but God.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
Perhaps there's a meaning here for you and me today. Paul says, therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he or she fall. I submit to you again that religion gives us a false sense of security. God's not going to save religion. Religion is ritual. And we think because we come up in here, as they say in the South, on Sabbath morning, and we sing a song that moves us, and we think because we are keeping God's holy Sabbath that somehow we are on God's green list. I'm going there this morning. Some of us think because we are Seventh-day Adventists and that we know something about the signs of the times, and we know something about when Jesus Christ is coming back. We think we got it going on. I got news for you. God's not going to save denominations. God's going to save individuals that will do the right of their of his Father through Jesus Christ our Lord. Can you say amen?
Amen. Yes. Amen.
The problem with the Corinthians was that they thought because they were justified by God, they could sin with impunity. I say to you that God will not tolerate willful sin. The Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. When I was a young boy, I used to see how close I could get to the sin without committing sin. The nerve of me. But that's what happens when you're 13 years old and smelling yourself. I thought to myself, oh yeah, I can go over here and look. I can go over here and peep. I can go over here and not participate, but I can be over here and not commit sin. My dad called me one day and sat me down, and he said, son, he said, you need to stop trying to ride life's highway in the middle of the highway. Mm-hmm. He said, because there's some oncoming traffic called sin that will wipe you out. He said, as a matter of fact, you need to be as close to the guardrails of sin, of life, as you can, to be assured by Jesus Christ that you will remain sinless, not because you're good, but because of the grace of God.
Amen.
Paul reminds us in verse 13 of chapter 10 that no temptation has overtaken us except such as is common to man. And then he says, but God is faithful, who will not allow you or me to be tempted beyond what we are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape that we may be able to bear it. I need you to understand three important principles about the significance of but God in this context. Paul reminds us in our first installment, but God is rich in mercy, has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. For by grace, we are saved by God. God determines our good before we sin. You see, we've got to remember while we are down here on this sinful earth, in our flesh, God has made us to sit in heavenly places with Jesus. God's not going to save this flesh I have or you have, but he is going to save the spirit if he decides the spirit is right. Our affirmation of faith reminds us that God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth shall not perish, but have everlasting life. I'm tempted to ask you this morning, are you saved? Now, I've found a lot with many of us as Adventists, we don't know whether we're saved or not. We think, again, because we keep the Sabbath, we're saved. That is not the affirmation of our faith. The affirmation of our faith is Jesus Christ. And if we believe, and whatever the positive consequences are of believing, you and I will be saved.
Yes, amen.
We sit in these heavenly places. All we've got to do when we run into a situation is remember, but God, who's rich in mercy, but God will not allow you or me to be tempted except that he has prepared a way of escape.
Yeah.
But God. The second point I want you to remember, that but God, Paul says, who is faithful. The word faithful in the Greek comes from a word pistos, which means free from doubt, worthy to be believed, observant and steadfast to one's trust. We can trust Jesus. And this little stuff we're going through here right now called COVID-19, well, I want to use a word, but I can't use it, that I want to say about COVID-19. COVID-19 can go someplace, and it's not north. Why do I say that? I say that because we serve a God who is preparing us with this little windfall called COVID-19. But I am so glad that when I spend time with him three times a day when he beckons me, all right, Shelton, I need to see you. Mm-hmm. I feel that nothing can hurt me unless God allows it.
Yeah.
Why? Because but God mm-hmm. is faithful.
Yeah.
Number three. But God will make the way of escape. Mm. To escape means to get away from confinement. You and I are confined 24/7 with media. Some stuff you have to turn your back until the frame moves mm. because we have no business looking at it. And I'm learning in my older age, some stuff that I look at and have to pray about now, those images come up sometimes when I wake up in the morning. I don't need to be waking up with that foolishness on my mind. I need to be waking up with Jesus. Amen. The old Negro spiritual says, I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen. That is but God.
Yes.
And so my brothers and sisters, you got to remember that we serve a God who functions for us between the coordinating conjunction or conjoining us or uniting us to himself.
Mm-hmm.
How do I know? Because he went to the cross. When Jesus went to the cross, the very symbol of the cross is a conjoining between a horizontal bar, which is symbolic of humanity, and a vertical bar, the stipe, which is symbolic of being connected by Jesus Christ, who is in the center of the cross, who yes. lifts us up to yes. glory.
Yes, amen.
All because of but God.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it is my prayer today, as we go through this week, that we will understand that everything that we do, everything we do, we in fact must exist between but God.
Yes.
Because all that is before but is what God has done for us.
Mm-hmm.
All that comes after but is what God is going to do for us when he comes.
Yes.
But God is the arbiter. It is the connection. It is the link between heaven and hell.
Mm.
So as you go through this week, my brothers and sisters, you got to remember to say when times get strained and you feel like complaining, you feel like lashing out at God, you got to say, Holy Spirit, help me. And I can tell you from experience, he will help you. And then you got to say, but God, get one of them out. Because
mm-hmm.
God is not asleep. He doesn't get tired.
Mm-hmm.
He's not so busy. He doesn't know who's calling his name.
Yes.
But he has promised that he would never leave us
yes.
or forsake us.
Yes.
So I don't know about you. I'm about God.
Amen.
I'm about but God. But God,
yes.
in the name of the Father. But God, in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
But God, in the name of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we have heard your voice. We have heard your words.
Mm-hmm.
While we thank you for your grace, Lord, we're asking at this very moment that you will fill us with your spirit.
Yes.
Help us to covet, to covet your Holy Spirit
mm-hmm.
in such a way that when we feel like your presence is gone, Lord, help us to call out to the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
Help us to get back to you, Lord.
Yes.
Help us to seek your face of light. Help us to seek your wisdom. Help us to realize that we can do nothing without Jesus.
Yes.
But through Jesus Christ, we can do all things. Amen. That is our prayer for this day, Lord. And we praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, for who you are, for your love, for your grace, for your mercies. And we look forward, Lord, even on this earth until you return, to speaking in our hearts and in our minds to you and whispering your name. And we know not only will we be justified, but you will keep us from temptation. These things we ask in the strong name of Jesus Christ. Let the church say amen.
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 And amen.
Amen.
And now, my brothers and sisters, it is that time. It's that time of the service when we get the good news. Good news through our updates from our dear sister, Dr. Esther Biamonte.
Amen.
Esther?
Good morning. Thank you so much, Pastor, for that inspiring message and the reminder to turn away from all the distractions and nonsense and just focus on you, knowing that but God is going to do all wonderful and beautiful things. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Three things we wanted to provide for you as updates for this week. The first is just a quick reminder that the San Diego County has a second wave of COVID rental assistance that's available. It is like the first one. It is a selection via lottery, paid directly to the landlord. And if you or your family or anyone you know has been impacted by COVID and needs this rental assistance, please feel free to apply at covid19rentalassistance.sandiegocounty.gov. The second update, and we'll be doing this right up until November 3rd. The second update is that we're now 4 weeks from the elections and the mail-in ballots should arrive at your mailbox today. We are just encouraging you to vote both up and down the ballot. Of course, there's a lot of focus on the presidential election and a lot of focus on the Senate and the House. But we also need to vote for our local officials. Since the mayor is the one who appoints the chief of police, and the chief of police is the one who determines what the tenor is going to be at the police force and how we're treated. It's judges that are placing the sentences disproportionately on our young people. The city councils hold a lot of power in terms of funds, determining how these funds will be allocated within the community. And therefore, it is critically important that we also not only vote for the national elections, but we also vote for our local candidates, those who support our values of justice, of equality, and of support for our communities. And there are a lot of ways that you can find out about the local candidates, the League of Women Voters, the ACLU. One that we're providing here is Voters Edge. Just type in your zip code, it'll bring up your ballots and allow you to just have a look at the situations and the values of each of these candidates. And then the third and final update for this morning is that we are so excited about a health and wellness series and seminar series that will be coming up shortly. We are so privileged and honored to have such a high caliber of health and mental care professionals. And so Dr. Marcia Gale Davis, Dr. Colin Ross, Dr. Marco Biamonte, and Kendra Mills Miller have agreed to collaborate together to provide us with tools for health and emotional wellness and well-being, tools on dealing with anxiety, stress, trauma of all kinds, including grief and loss, physical and emotional health, COVID education, and so much more. And so we are really excited about this. In order to tailor the seminar specifically to our needs, we will be sending out a survey next week. The survey is completely anonymous and will be extremely helpful in shaping and prioritizing the topics that these healthcare professionals will be discussing. We would like this seminar series to be both in reach as well as outreach. So it doesn't matter what our religion is or whether we have any religion or not, we could all use these tools. And so I'm sharing that with not only within our church community, but to our friends and our relatives and our community at large. So feel free to forward the survey, put those links on your social media platform, get the word out so that we can continue to tailor this seminar series for the benefit of our church family as well as the community. And then finally, just a word of encouragement, wanted to join with Pastor and Sister Pendeza and Terry and just encouraging the church family. I don't know about you, but I'm just tired, you guys. I'm tired emotionally, physically, mentally, just feeling at the rope's end, especially over these last sort of 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. But at least for me, just stopping to breathe and to remember the goodness of God. But God and his amazing, wonderful grace, when we look back all across our entire lives to remember how God has guided us and taken us marvelously through, they're just blessings on blessings. Mm-hmm. And even during this pandemic, when we think about how he has kept us in our families, just blessings on blessings. And even despite our losses and our grief and our suffering and our trials, he has been there to support and to comfort us, just blessings upon blessings. Strength for today, blessings on blessings, and hope for tomorrow. Great is his faithfulness. So we just want you today to be encouraged as we move forward during this week. Take lots of big hugs and let's stand in the light of God's joy and his blessings. Mm-hmm. Passing it back to you, Pastor Kilby, for the benediction.
Thank you so much, Dr. Esther. That message that you've given us is all that needs to be said. And I hope everyone that's listening, as you go through this weekend and come into next weekend, that you will feel empowered. There's something about Sabbath day rest.
Yes.
That we may bring all of this fatigue, but there's something that's intangible, it's immeasurable, and I would say it's the Spirit of God that strengthens us and gives us pep for the next week.
Yes.
So those words said, I want to close with our benediction. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty,
yes,
dominion and power,
mm-hmm,
both now and forever. Let the church say amen.
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 And amen.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is not a drill. It's time for you to speak what you want to see. And if you're with it, then repeat after me. Come on. Turn around, blessings, blessings,
blessings,
every time blessings. Yeah, every time I turn around, blessings on blessings. Hey. Yes, sir. I see blessings. Blessings.
Every time I turn around,
there will be blessings on blessings.
Blessings, yeah. Every time I